Our next guests will share how they are growing their company while navigating the murky legal waters of the rapidly evolving hospitality industry. Joining us from Airbnb, please welcome for the first time ever together on the Brainstorm Tech stage, Brian Chesky and Belinda Johnson.
Hey, how you doing?
Hi.
Hello.
Thanks for joining me. Hey, guys.
Thanks for having us.
All right. So I have a quick question. There hasn't been a single session that people haven't been talking about Pokemon Go. So my question to you is, are you thinking about this as part of your business strategy? Can I capture Pokemon in Airbnbs?
Well, it's pretty amazing. I heard there's one Pokemon you have to go to Italy for. So
yeah?
Yeah, so maybe there's a travel partnership here.
This doesn't sound terrible.
Yeah,
all right,
exactly.
I actually have it on my phone. My kids download it.
Do you? It's incredible. Everybody's talking about it.
I tried it out with my girlfriend. We were walking around the city, and I had that incredibly embarrassing moment where somebody, you feel like people are watching you, like, oh God, they've caught me. I'm doing Pokemon. And then I realized I actually caught them too. They were doing it too.
There you go. There you go. It's mutual. All right. So you guys just had a big milestone. We were talking, in my introduction, I said fast growing, of course. But you just had a milestone yesterday, right? 100 million users? Did I get it right?
Guest arrivals.
Guest arrivals. And that's quite a bit bigger than it was before. It was 60 million at the end of last year. And what was it, 40 a whole year before? So you're really picking up steam.
Yes.
How are you dealing with this? This is the big question for any startup. How are you dealing with this scale? How are you managing it technologically, culturally, et cetera? This is extraordinary.
Yeah, so it's been pretty amazing to be able to have a couple million homes around the world, 100 million guest arrivals. And to put that in perspective, this weekend around the world, we'll have about 1.5 million people staying in a home. And these people are going to come from about 190 countries all over the world. This is an incredibly challenging kind of scale because you're dealing with all sorts of countries. But not only that, you know, there's a lot of internet companies that operate in every country. We operate in every neighborhood, in people's homes. And so it's kind of like the internet moving into your neighborhood, into the real world. And so in many ways, this is a really huge challenge. How do you actually do this? And obviously, people's vacations. Once a year vacation is one of the most important things in people's lives. In fact, people spend as much as 30 hours planning vacations. And so we felt like being able to manage this was going to be a critical issue. And one of the things we did, and this is why I'm really excited to talk to Belinda, was I think so much of our success was stemmed when we met in 2011. I remember we met in 2011. We met with investors, and Mark Andreessen, one of our investors, said, you know, we're really excited about this business, but there's two risks to the company. Regulatory and what he called the founder's show, the founders running the company. And it became very clear to me that how we navigate this idea could make or break this concept around the world. And so that's when we met in late 2011. And in all candor, like my initial instinct to be able to how to work with cities was to actually avoid cities that where we'd have conflict. And when I met Belinda, she taught me a really important lesson. And the important lesson was that you have to partner with cities. And to partner with cities, you have to meet them face-to-face, put a face to the city, puts a face to you. They learn about you, you educate them about your business. And this was totally counterintuitive, because my intuition was to avoid them, but she said, no, you have to learn, you have to partner. And since then, the last 5 years, we've been going city and city, meeting and partnering with cities.
I think our public policy approach has been an evolution over time. I mean, when I first started in the early days, you know, we'd meet with city officials and policymakers, and there was just general skepticism, I think, about kind of whether a lot of people would ever use Airbnb. And so, you know, as a result, there just wasn't much focus on Airbnb. And so, you know, we spent that time really growing the community and engaging with the community, especially outside of the U.S. And then as we grew, we started to face more and more questions and more opposition from people who I don't think really had an understanding of what Airbnb was all about.
So let's talk about that. I mean, you've dealt with plenty of challenges. I remember in your early days, it was the creep factor of, you know, letting people into your home. Later on, it was whether or not they're going to wreck it. And you guys managed to get through all of that. Now you're in two big battles, right? Mm-hmm. Your hometown, San Francisco, and essentially my hometown, New York City, two big battles. no matter how much you talk to city officials, state officials, you can't resolve these two. Mm-hmm. They're for different reasons. I think New York wants to fine users if they rent their whole apartment, because there are very strict laws against that, for shorter than 30 days. San Francisco has its own setup around licensing or something like that. I can't remember. Bottom line, you're in a big battle with two important cities to the folks here. How are you dealing with this? Because I would have thought it would have been resolved by now.
Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, we've had a pretty long history with New York. I'll take New York first. And really, it's kind of informed a little bit how we deal with cities generally and our collaborative approach. I know that sounds a little counterintuitive, but when kind of these misperceptions started to get traction, it started to get traction in New York, where we had more vocal opposition. And so we found ourselves at a little bit of an inflection point in 2013 when the New York AG subpoenaed us for our user data. And I think, you know, for us at that time, as a relatively young company, we had to decide kind of what do we stand for and how do we want to go forward. And, you know, Brian's first comment then was, well, what would our community expect us to do? You know, so the first thing we did was spend a lot of time with our hosts in New York and understand kind of what their perspective was. And it became pretty clear to us that we were going to have to fight this fight, even though, you know, we didn't, that's not really where we wanted to be. And ultimately learned a lot from that experience. And, you know, we have really wanted to be very collaborative with cities, and not just in kind of designing regulation, but also in partnering around things like disaster relief and collecting and remitting taxes, disaster preparedness. And so this really started kind of the fundamental, you know, what we learned is we talked about our principles a lot internally.
Sure.
But we hadn't quite done enough externally to kind of...
Well, I was going to say, what's the lesson learned from the New York situation?
Perfect lesson.
Yeah.
New York City started as a conflict in June 2010.
Right.
Belinda joined more than a year later. It's much harder if the moment you meet a city, you meet them because there's a problem, and other people have told those city officials, there's a major problem with Airbnb, what are you going to do about it? The moment you walk into that meeting, I can guarantee you that's a very tough first meeting. San Francisco and New York, in my opinion, are not leading indicators. They are actually the two first cities that we built in our community. And before, again, our intuition was to wait for a problem. And what we've learned since then is that you don't wait for a problem. If you want to do business in a city, you should get to know that city. You should partner with that city. We have tax agreements now in over 200 cities around the world, and we're in active discussions with hundreds of more cities. Many of these cities, we try to preempt the conversations because we've learned with San Francisco to New York, if you get to a city first, you typically come with best of intentions. You come from a place of partnership. If a city comes to you and you wait for them, then here's what you have. You could have many, many years of potential conflict. The only other thing I would say is when articles get written about Airbnb in New York and San Francisco, they usually use one of three images below the website. They'll either use Airbnb's logo, image of the homepage, or my photo. That's great. And it's like a battle. And the point of the matter is we're in 34,000 cities. Yes, these two cities matter to our business, but these cities are very, very low single-digit percentages of our business. But they are a huge percentage of the importance of our community. And one of the things that I think has always guided our company is we are a company of, by, and for the community. Like, our product is not a website. Our website is the store. Our product are these hosts. And we have millions of them around the world. And we've ultimately, and as Belinda said, had to have guiding principles that we had to stick up for them. And our North Star is just talking to them. And our community has really guided us to say, like, this is how, what we believe in, and here's how we want to deal with it.
San Francisco's your backyard.
Yeah.
Why has it, you know, you've put so much emphasis on talking. Surely you've talked to them more than you've talked to anyone else.
So we've been working with San Francisco for a number of years, and I think it has most recently kind of culminated into where we are today. But in San Francisco, you have to, if you're going to rent your space out on a short-term basis, you need to register. And I think kind of the frustration with the registration system for our hosts has been really problematic. Brian says it was easier to...
It's easier to start your company. If I knew
register.
It was this many steps to start Airbnb, you would have thought twice. It can take literally months and dozens of steps to register your home. So I think that's fundamentally one of the problems.
So we want to keep working on that. And,
sure.
And in the meantime, you know, we've made progress with a lot of other cities. You know, we just announced a partnership with Chicago, and they have new legislation where we're working on a pass-through registration so that we can help – enable the registration for our hosts.
So one thing that I was wondering with regard to the New York situation, right, it's near and dear to my heart. I live in New York. Is that a lot of the problem that you've run into in New York is that the laws are you know, kind of there for the hotel industry. And you've run into those issues. Well, we're not doing the same thing that they are doing. Da, da. How do you frame your company today? How far along? The reason I bring up New York is because they have, you know, restrictions on how many days and how much of your home. And they're clearly trying to figure out what is an Airbnb and what is a hotel room. How do you think about that? To what end? You know, where does your business stop and the hotel business start?
Right. I think the challenge of our business is that regulators have historically wanted to fit you into a box. And there's a very clear two boxes, private citizens and businesses. The moment you handle money, you're viewed as a business. And if you're viewed as a business in hospitality, then suddenly, the moment you have one person in your home, you could be regulated similarly, or they would have the inclination to regulate you like a hotel. Well, hotels have all sorts of regulations for them. And as we've gone city by city, we're, by the way, happy to pay hotel tax, and we pay the same hotel rate as the hotels in 200 cities. But we've said there's people, there's businesses, and there's a third category, people as businesses, and that you have to think of people doing this supplementally, in supplemental income. The average host in the United States makes $7,500. This is not the Marriott. This is not Hilton. We need to make sure that we want to be regulated, but those regulations are proportional to the activity happening in neighborhoods. And by the way, all these regulations are meant to protect consumers, and we think that we have a lot of these protections in place. I think a big thing is just educating the public and educating cities about what we're doing, and this is kind of part of what we're doing. The one other thing I'll say, though, is this. When you do read about Airbnb, you sometimes read about Airbnb, and they've got all these homes, all these spaces. And it's very easy to look at Airbnb and think, we are a marketplace of spaces. And I think that's misunderstanding what this company is about. Our company is really about other people. Our mission is we want you to feel like you can go to a neighborhood anywhere in the world and you feel like you live in that neighborhood, even if it's for that night. And what makes you feel in the neighborhood isn't necessarily just staying in a home. It's the hosts, the people that actually welcome you. This is ultimately, I believe, a people-powered brand. And with all the anxiety in the economy today, there are challenges in our business, but I think there's also hope. The notion that somebody can participate in this economy and actually be able to make an income. And so if you ask me, like, what are the challenges keeping me up at night, there's a lot of them. But I would say, personally, cities is not one of my biggest challenges. In fact, the biggest obstacle to our mission are things like discrimination that we're having on the platform.
Sure.
That is a much bigger obstacle to creating a world where 191 countries can belong than New York and San Francisco, though I take those seriously. And this is something else that Belinda and I are spending a lot of time on, because this is deeply important to us.
So I was thinking about this earlier because I attended our diversity panel this morning,
right,
which was really informative. Mm-hmm. And you know, you're basically referencing the Airbnb Wall Black hashtag,
yes,
and all that kind of stuff, and the idea that there can be discrimination when renting out spaces. And this is, I was really thinking about it because this is a hard thing. You're dealing with people. You know, it's not that you're inherently discriminating, but part of your product allows people to do that. How are you thinking about that from a company standpoint, how you're messaging your own employees? Mm-hmm. How are you thinking about this from a product standpoint? How are you building it to maybe, you know, try to work that out as best you can?
So I can talk maybe high level. Belinda's actually leading this effort. I'll just tell you kind of as a founder how I think about this. Generally speaking, you know, I think we were late to this issue. And I think one of the questions is, well, why were you so late to this issue? I think we were so focused on a notion of trust and keeping people safe that we wanted to have everyone have a real identity with photos, make sure, because we were responding to other crises of trust and safety. And while that happened, we took our eye off the ball on this incredibly important issue. And what we noticed was that people were making judgments about who to be let in their home. And by the way, people should have a choice of who would be in their home, but what choices are they deciding? These choices were very subjective and discriminatory, potentially. And one guiding principle is that you want to give people tools so they can make objective measures. We commissioned our own study in Stanford, and one of the things we found is there can be discrimination if everyone's a stranger. You tend to snap judgment to predispositions you know. But if you see somebody's reviews and you learn about them and where they went to school, the moment you can take the stranger out of somebody, and this isn't just about race, this could be about countries.
Sure.
Suddenly, this levels the playing field. And so what we need to do, first and foremost, is add objective measures so that people don't rely on, you know, prejudice. That being said, there are racists in the world, and we need to have a zero tolerance. And we absolutely have zero tolerance. And so we've developed a better escalation system. So if we hear something in the community, we absolutely make a stand in the community. But the last thing I'll say in blanket takeover is we are basically in the middle of a 90-day study. Because we're also realizing when we designed the platform, Joe, Nate, and I, three white guys, there's a lot of things we didn't think about when we designed this platform. And so there's a lot of steps that we need to reevaluate.
Yeah, I would just add, you know, we've always had policies in place, but I think the last few months has we've had a lot of learnings, and so we've brought in experts to help us. We hired Laura Murphy, who is a former head of ACLU in Washington, and to come and really spearhead this for us, so that we understand the issues a lot better, and we're gonna do a full review, top to bottom, of our entire platform to make sure that in every design, in every kind of part of the product, that inclusion is top of mind. And so we're going to be kind of rolling things out over the next 90 days. And
how do you think about this issue, right? So of course, you want it to be perfectly inclusive, you know, your product, your company. There isn't an executive who wouldn't say that. Mm-hmm. However, how do you look at the liability of it? You know, when you were subject, you were pilloried for this very early on, and, you know, how much of it do you look at it and go, this is something that is our responsibility to fix, or this is society, and I don't know how much we can do?
Gosh, I think we have not focused as much on a pure liability standpoint, because we feel like we have a responsibility.
That not, you know, in a legal standpoint.
Yeah, but a moral obligation to ensure that everyone on our platform is treated fairly. And I think it's not just, the leaders in the company doing it. This is a kind of a whole company effort, and we're engaging with our own employees and our community to find the best path here. Part of that is, you know, in the company creating a safe space to even have the conversations. Yeah. We recently hired a head of diversity and inclusion, David King, who is kind of helping us with all of these issues, and part of that is giving people the tools to even have the conversations.
Fair enough.
The one thing I'll say is, kind of in the height of, or when this controversy started bubbling up, I sent an email to the entire company. And in the email, one of the first things I said is the inclination of a company and a chief executive is when there's an issue, the inclination is to address the issue. I wrote it in quotes, address the issue. Because what does address the issue mean? Address the issue sounds to me like doing the minimum amount of work to stay out of trouble. And it's kind of, this is kind of what these topics are. But I said that Airbnb was a little bit different than other companies. Because again, if you're trying to bring people together from different backgrounds, different races, different cultures, then discrimination for most companies is an adjacency to their mission. Your mission is whatever's most important to you. Our thing most importantly is to bring people together. This was an obstacle to our mission. And that if we merely tried to address the issue, we would actually probably not accomplish our mission. And so we had two choices. We could either address the issue, which I think would be on the wrong side of history, or be a forgotten part of history, or we can actually, I mean, one of the great things about technology is we have the opportunity to kind of drive change that we hope the rest of the world will mirror. And that is, I think, why we are under such scrutiny, but we also have such responsibility. Yeah. And so then the question they ask the companies, what kind of world do you want to live in? Mm-hmm. And then we should lead by example. We're not going to create that world, but we should set the example.
Mm-hmm. Good point. I'm going to come to the audience for questions in 1 minute, but I have I want to talk about a different segment of your community, and that's the business community.
Right.
How are you addressing them? You have Airbnb for Business.
Right.
You have the numbers. This is all anecdotal, but I still don't get the sense that executives are really into it. How are you looking at entering that business, really?
Mm-hmm. So, you know, business travel is actually one of the fastest growing segments on Airbnb. In fact, anyone that works at a company of probably more than 100 employees knows that you need to travel for business, you need to be able to expense things, you need to sign up with a travel management company. Today, we announced that we already signed up with Concur. Today, we announced that we integrate now with American Express Business, and we are also in the process of integrating with two others, Carlson Wagner and one other. But more importantly, we actually started this effort about a year ago. The response has been pretty crazy. 10% of our business about a year ago was business travel, and that is growing quite significantly. We have tens of thousands of companies that are signed up, and I believe Google, 10% of Google's travel is now purchased through Airbnb, 10% of Google employees. And these stories are spreading company by company. I think the problem with travel was that business travel was kind of the last people. The travel managers were probably the last people that were going to get comfortable with this. And so I think we had to kind of prove a sense of scale and reputation. But the more these travel managers and companies learned about us, the more they learned two things. Number one, you can save a lot of money. Now, somebody cares about saving money. Either the company cares about it, or a lot of companies, employees get to keep their per diem, so they care about it. The other thing, though, is that people really love the experience. One example, a lot of our business travel is for 6 nights or even longer. If you have to stay in a hotel and you're traveling with 5 other people, where are you going to meet? You're going to meet in one of your rooms, like sit at the end of the bed? At Airbnb, you can actually sit around the kitchen table. And so we started realizing maybe a one-night overnight isn't our sweet spot. But if you're traveling with a number of people and you have to go for a little bit longer, the one thing we learned is the longer you're away from home, the more you seek a home. And you can have that in a city.
We see more and more employees are asking their employers, because they're traveling for their personal kind of vacations, and asking employers to allow this. And it isn't just kind of the corporate world. This year, the state of California passed new legislation to allow 228,000 state employees to be able to use Airbnb for travel for the state.
Fascinating. All right, let's go to the audience for questions. Questions, yes. Right here, up front, thank you. And please identify yourself, thank you.
Hey Brian, Mark Mahaney at RBC. You've been running a lot of TV campaigns just in the last 3 to 6 months. Can you talk about how well they've done? And then could you also just talk about the strategy, 100 million guest arrivals. Boy, you could do a lot more with them than what you're doing today. How do you think about expanding vertically or horizontally with those guest arrivals? Thanks.
Really good question, Mark. So one of the core reasons we ran these commercials, two reasons. One, we just want more people to know about Airbnb, and travel is a very top of mind kind of thing. But there's something much more important, and actually it leads to what you're talking about. We've talked about our mission, but our mission, the words like feeling like you could belong anywhere, were a little abstract for people. And we were trying to explain, like, why should you use Airbnb? We actually asked our community. Our community, we surveyed them. We asked them, what's the number one reason you use Airbnb? Obviously, people would probably assume it's to save money. And that was the third reason. The number one reason people said they travel on Airbnb is they want to live like a local. That is the reason why people travel. It's very much why we exist. And so I remember asking Belinda and some other executives, I asked this rhetorical question, where have you lived? And one of our executives said, oh, 3 places. I said, well, where have you traveled? And they said, oh, I've traveled to 50 places around the world. And I said, what if in the future I asked you the question, where have you lived, and you'd say all the places on Airbnb? It was a mindset that you're not a tourist, you're not an outsider, you can feel like you live there. Well, part of feeling like you live there means maybe there's more than just a home. And so I don't unfortunately have any news to announce, except to say that we are, Belinda and I and others, are very focused, and we've been working for quite a long time, on thinking about the end-to-end journey. I don't travel to Paris to stay at home, I travel to Paris to have a trip. There's a lot of other verticals that we're looking at.
All right. Any more? Oh, yes, right in the back. Thank you.
Can you hear me?
Oh, there we go.
Yes. My question was...
Could you identify yourself?
My name is Kimberly Bryan. I'm the founder and CEO of Black Girls Code. And I had a question to circle back on the issue of Airbnb while Black. That kind of popped off this year or so and came really a thing, especially in social media. But I tweeted about this last year because we had an incident that I experienced as a new employee was coming into the Bay Area, and I was looking to put this person up for about a week or two as they were doing training. And we were not able to do that. I was not able to get a reservation for her. So of course my picture shows up, but also my email, it says kbryan@blackgirlscode.org. And so it was clear to us when this happened that we would have folks that a rental was available, and then it would go away once they saw who I was and the organization. So there was clear bias. So I was not surprised when this issue hit this year. But I guess my challenge to you is, you know, I appreciate that you guys are doing a 90-day study, but I wonder, do you not recognize that some of the issues and the design of the product as is being driven by the fact that it's not inclusive design? There are biases that have been allowed to be a part of your platform Perhaps, because there's only 2% black people that work at Airbnb. There's only 3% Hispanics that are part of the Airbnb community. And if we go down further into the tech ranks, it's like 1%. So I think it's really important that companies, especially Bay Area startup companies like yourself, are really understanding that to be an creative, inclusive product, you need an inclusive organization. So while I appreciate the redesign efforts, I really would challenge you to look at what are the employee makeups like at your companies, and how can you actually do more to hire engineers, to hire designers that would be able to look at your product from this lens so that you're not behind the curve trying to solve a social equity issue, and that you have people around the table that can design for inclusivity. That's a long-winded.
I was going to say, yes, bravo. We're almost out of time, so just one brief comment, please.
Well, yeah. I totally agree with everything you said. Mm-hmm. It's a huge issue. And one of the things that we've learned is culture at Airbnb is so important, because what happens inside the building often manifests outside the building. And so we try to design our company inside out. There is no question we are late. This is a problem in tech. It's a problem in Airbnb. And we are completely, I mean, this is a huge part of the focus about, on this.
100% committed and agree with everything you said. It's so important to have the diversity at the table in the design process. And so we're 100% committed to doing more on this. Absolutely.
Thank you all. And a round of applause, please, for the Airbnb folks. Thank you.
Thank you.